Adventures in Music is on the road again, and on this occasion we're visiting the Van Wezel Performing Arts Hall in Sarasota, Florida. Overlooking the Gulf of Mexico, this landmark building, designed by the architect Frank Lloyd Wright, is the only purple seashell-shaped hall in the world. Owned and operated by the city of Sarasota, it opened its doors in 1968, and since that time it has been presenting a broad spectrum of the world's finest performing artists for 40 years. Today is no exception, and this evening's concert will feature one of the greatest musicians of this generation. Often known affectionately, and with good reason, as the man with the golden flute, Sir James Galway is also one of the most recorded artists of our time. With his amazing ability to give flawless performances of both the virtuoso flute repertoire and the popular classics, he has now sold well over 30 million records during his extraordinary career. I have had the good fortune to have known Sir James Galway for many years, and I'm so proud of his many successes and achievements. I'm also delighted to have the opportunity to talk with him today about his life and his devotion on an instrument that he so clearly loves, the flute. Sir James, you were born, I think, in Belfast, Northern Ireland, is that correct?
Yeah, I grew up there too.
And you played from an early age, I think, did you not?
Well, I started playing when I was around about nine, and I learned from my Uncle Joe, who learned the flute from my grandfather, and my dad played the flute. Everybody in the street practically played the flute, and of course, we were all part of that huge flute band movement that takes place in Northern Ireland.
Right, do they still have flute bands today?
Oh, sure, but they're not the same.
Really?
No, because they sold all their instruments and they got instruments like this in silver. And you know, they had, before they had piccolos, then they had B-flat flutes, which were a little bit bigger than piccolos. Then they had flutes in F and E-flat for the middle section of the band, and then they had bass flutes.
Right.
But when you heard a band in the street, you could hear all these voices, because the little flutes carried it right up there. But now with concert flutes, it all sounds the same because they're all in the same register, so to speak.
Well, that's interesting. Now, you started on a little five-key little flute that somebody gave you, uncle maybe gave you?
Yeah, no, somebody in the street gave
you. Oh, that's right, it was a neighbor who gave it to you.
Yeah.
And then your uncle eventually gave you a flute which belonged to the flute band.
That's
presumably.
Right, and I learned on that.
Right, and he gave you some lessons, I think, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
When did you realize, Jim, that you wanted to go into the profession?
Well, I didn't. I just wandered into it, and here I am. I mean, I never had a wish to be a professional musician. It's something I just did, and I just went along with the band, so to speak.
Right, and then you met Muriel Dawn.
Yes.
And that presumably was really an important moment in your life, in your flute playing life.
I mean, Muriel, she had already learned the flute from two people. One from your father, who embraced the French school of flute playing, and one from Robert Murchie, who embraced the English school.
Right.
So she could choose what she thought was the best, and she decided to go for the French school. And I'm very happy about that, because I consider myself to be French trained.
Right, yes. Well, of course, my father was really obviously very keen on the French school, too.
Oh, sure.
I didn't realize until I was researching a little bit about your life, even though I've known you quite well for many years, I didn't realize you went to Crunel in Paris. I always thought you went to Rampal.
No, he didn't teach.
Ah,
I mean,
okay.
Having a lesson with Jean-Pierre consisted of white wine and oysters and beer and stuff like that, and maybe a chat about the flute. But the first time I played the flute for him, he said, you know, Jimmy, you should get yourself a job in an orchestra. That's all
really?
He said.
Oh, really?
He was sort of wrong about that, wasn't he? Well, he was right, but
well,
he was also,
well, 6 months later,
you know,
I did.
Yes. well, now, I was going to ask about, you played in London, you played in the London orchestras, because
yes.
you actually sat next to a mutual friend of ours, William Bennett.
Yes,
did
I
you
did.
Not? Was that at Sadler's Wells?
Was Sadler's Wells. He was a solo flute player, but then part the way into the season, William decided to go and pick elderberries and stuff like that to make
really?
Wine.
Oh,
and he took a couple of days off to do that, so they told him not to come back.
Oh, really?
And
and you got the job,
I
presumably.
I got the job,
yes.
Yeah.
It's funny, because you were saying you were earning £21 a week at the time.
Yeah.
And I was playing in the Festival Ballet, and I was earning 19, but so they were paying you more than they were paying me for
yeah,
playing
well,
the violin.
Yeah, well, you see, there you are. Solo flute player's worth £2
obviously,
more.
Obviously, yes, obviously. so you played, of course, with all the great London orchestras, I mean, or most of them. The London Symphony Orchestra, you were in for a short
yes,
time,
and
I
the
think.
Royal Philharmonic.
Right. And then there was the moment when you decided to go for the Berlin audition.
Mm-hmm.
And I want you to tell me about that audition, please.
Well, it was an interesting experience, because I went along there and arrived at the Deutsches Museum in Munich, where it was held, at 12 o'clock. And when I got there, I met Wolfgang Stresemann, who said to me, "Ah, you don't need to play because the standard is so high."
Oh, really?
Yes. So I was not ready for this.
No.
And he asked me why I was late, very aggressive. I said, "Well, I'm not late, actually. I'm on time according to your invitation, which is noon, and it's 10 past noon." And he said, "But we changed it to 9:30. I said, "Well, maybe you did, but nobody told me."
Boy.
And he said, "Well, we sent you a telegram." I said, "Well, maybe if you were reading the newspapers, you'd realize that the British Post Office has been on strike for a week and nobody gets anything."
Right.
I said to him, "Well, you know, if you had any manners at all, you would hear me play."
Mm-hmm.
He said, "But it's not necessary and we will pay your fare." I said, "I know that, because that's in the agreement which you signed." I was really angry, I can tell you.
Well,
so then
sure
he
is.
Went away and came back, and he said, "The maestro will hear you." So I walked into the stage, asked the piano player if he would like to play the Ebert Flute Concerto, and he declined. He said he would prefer to play a Mozart concerto, so I said, "Which one? D major?" So we went with the D major. And after that, a voice from the 120 people listening said, "Okay, play Lapri Meteor, play this, play mm-hmm, that, and mm-hmm. play William Tell, play Heldenhaven." So I played all these things, and nobody gave me any music.